Bibles, go ahead and turn with me to John 1. We're going to be there here in just a minute. We'll read that together. But first, I want to go to the Lord in prayer together, pray over this time through His Word. And also, I want to pray, as I do for another local church, I want to pray for Mallard Point Baptist Church this morning as they continue their search for a pastor. And so let's go to the Lord together in prayer. God, we are just overwhelmed this morning of the truths that we've been able to see, to reflect now on the fact that You have created all things, that all creatures can proclaim the fact that You are our God, that You have made us, the fact that You have done that for all eternity, that we may know You, that we may worship You, that we may crown You as King of our lives forever. God, You are that great. You are so worthy of our praise this morning. We are thankful to be able to sing that, hopefully out of the experience of our own hearts and our own lives this morning. God, we just pray for Mallard Point Baptist Church here in Georgetown this morning. We ask that You would lead them to the man that You would have lead their congregation as pastor. Lord, I know they've been through this process for quite a while now, and we just pray that You would direct their steps, guide their thinking to the person that You would have pastor them. Lord, we know that You never leave us or forsake us as Your people, and so that is our prayer for that congregation, that You would not leave them or forsake them, that they would find You, that they would experience life with You, and that they would be led by a faithful shepherd, one who loves You and loves the gospel and preaches it faithfully. Lord, we pray for all the churches that preach Christ here in Georgetown, that they would be faithful to Your word, that they would preach both grace and truth as You called us to do, that people may know You in a new way because of that. We know that You call us to be Your instruments, to take Your gospel, Your good news to those around us. Lord, as we prepare our hearts to hear Your word this morning, may we set aside all the burdens, all the cares that are in our hearts and in our minds that we've struggled with this week, even this morning maybe, that we may turn our attention fully to You, that we may hear from You, know that Your word brings life to us. May we experience You this morning. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So today we're going to start a new sermon series, and we're going to go through the book of John together. We're going to look at from the beginning to the end, and we're going to have a few breaks where we'll look up some other things in the process. But, you know, in the New Testament, if you're not familiar with the Bible, there's four Gospels, right? There's Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. We call those the Gospels because they tell the story of Jesus, the time that He came to earth and lived here on earth to the time that He died and was resurrected from the dead. And each Gospel had different themes. Right, so some of the Gospels emphasized the kingdom of God, which we've sung about a little bit this morning. Some emphasized the fact that Jesus was the Jewish Messiah that had been long anticipated. But as we come to the book of John, what we're going to see is John really emphasizes that Jesus is God come in the flesh. That God has come to us as a man. And that's the thing John really wants us to grab a hold of and grasp the weight of what that means for us. And if we think about, well, what's the theme of the book within that? John 20, verse 31, really is a theme verse for the whole book. So I want to read that for us this morning so we can just kind of start thinking along those lines, okay? So John 20, verse 31 says, talking about the words that he's written up to this point, it's at the end of the book. He says, "But these are written so that you may believe Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and by believing, you may have life in His name." So this is really what John wants us to understand as we read through, as we study through this book together. He wants us to believe who Jesus really is and to find life in believing that. So we're going to call this sermon series Believe and Live, because this is what God wants for us. He wants us to believe the truth, to know it deeply, the truth of who Jesus really is, and to live as a result of that, and really live. So as we think about that, we're starting at the beginning of the book, and as we know, in life, beginnings are important, Right? Beginnings really set the stage for what's going to come afterwards. So many of you all have heard the importance of a first impression, right? The old adage that you only get one chance to make a first impression. And why do we say that? Well, we say it because first impressions are important, right? We can't take back that initial thing, the initial impression we make on people. We've got to do it well, or people are going to see us through a skewed lens if we don't. So think about, for instance, a job interview. So you only get one chance, one crack at a job interview. And for some of you all, you may get very nervous realizing that. For some of you all, you may be able to kind of take it in stride, but you only get one chance. And I've had several job interviews over my lifetime, and you know, you want to put your best foot forward and make them know and believe that you're right for that job. You got to make that good first impression to do that. Or maybe if you want to date somebody, right? You want to put your good impression forward because you want to impress that person. Hey, I like this person. I think I might see a future with them. I want to do whatever I can to make them like me. And so, you know, you may spend time getting yourself ready. If you're a woman, you may put on makeup and all that. If you're a guy, you may give yourself a pep talk in the mirror and rehearse your lines and all that good stuff. I don't know if any of you all did that or not. But you want to make that good first impression on that lady or on that man that you want to go on a date with. And so the Apostle John, who is the one who's writing this gospel, one of Jesus' 12 disciples, he's one of his closest followers, kind of the inner circle of Jesus. He realizes this. He knows, look, if we're going to be Christians who live out the plan of God that God wants for us in our lives and the great things that entails, we have to get the beginning right. We have to have a foundation that we can build on. And so John doesn't start with the birth of Jesus like some of the other gospels do. He goes even further back than that. He goes to the very beginning of all things. And so with that in mind, let's read verses 1 through 13 together of John 1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. All things were created through Him, and apart from Him, not one thing was created that has been created. Life was in Him, and that life was the light of men. That light shines in the darkness, yet the darkness did not overcome it. There was a man named John, who was sent from God. He came as a witness to testify about the light, so that all might believe through him. He was not the light, but he came to testify about the light. The true light, who gives light to everyone, was coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world was created through him. Yet the world did not recognize him. He came to his own, and his own people did not receive him. But to all who did receive him, he gave the right to be children of God. To those who believe in his name, who were born not of blood, or of the will of the flesh, or of the will of man, but of God. And this is God's word for us this morning. A powerful passage, so much rich theological truth in this passage that we need to know and we need to understand as Christians. You know, the book of John is often a book that is walked through with new believers because it's so foundational in understanding who Jesus really is and who we are meant to be as Christians. So as we read through this passage this morning, as we think about what we just read, I want us to grab onto this one truth that is going to kind of shape our thinking this morning, all right? And that is that Jesus is fundamentally a giver of life. He is fundamentally a giver of life, and he wants us to have life with him. He wants us to have life with him, all right? So 39 times in the book of John, the word life is mentioned. You think it was important to him, maybe. 39 times, yes. It's a key theme that he's trying to drive home. We need to have life with God. And God wants us to experience that. And maybe today you're feeling like, man, I do not feel very alive this morning. It could be I'm just tired. It could be that life has just beating me down and I'm just worn out and tired and struggling. And God has a word for us. I want to give you life. I want to breathe life into you today. And so let's look together at how that happens. What we have to know and understand in the depths of our soul for that to happen. So three things I want us to see that John shows us, right? The first thing we need to know, if we're going to have that kind of life, is we need to know that Jesus is God, first of all. We need to know that Jesus is God. Look at verses 1 and 2 together. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. So first thing I want us to notice is the first words, in the beginning. And what John is talking about here is the beginning of all things. He's talking about creation. He's taking us all the way back to the foundational starting point of all things, and he's saying something was there. Someone was there at that point. And who was that? It was the Word. And in the Old Testament, this idea of the Word is a referring of what God was saying to people. It's how he was revealing who he was. So he spoke through prophets. He spoke through the written Word. But he disclosed himself through creation, through revelation, through salvation in the Old Testament. And we call that his Word. Right? He spoke and prophets spoke on behalf of him. In the New Testament, we now see the Word comes to actually refer to a person. It is God disclosing himself to us in the shape and in the form of a human being. And we know this is Jesus Christ. And we see that in verse 14, which we're going to be talking about next week, where it says the Word became flesh. Right? This is Jesus, fully God, fully man. And God is telling us and showing us, speaking to us through Jesus, through a person, and showing us who he really is. So when John says the Word, he's talking about Jesus. We have to keep that in mind. So when you read the Word, you can also kind of in your mind think, in the beginning was Jesus. And God is teaching us through that. And so this is how John introduces Jesus to us. He is an expression of God's own self, the full deity of God. And it was in the beginning. And so these words, in the beginning, when we read that, at the beginning of verse 1, Jewish readers who heard that or who read that would automatically go back to the story that they'd all been raised with and heard. The stories that their parents had taught them from the time they were little kids. He's talking about creation here. He's talking about the first words of the Bible, Genesis 1:1. John is actually telling us that Jesus was there, that he was active in it. Verse 3, it says that all things were created through him, and nothing was created apart from him. So they're saying, look, all things were created through Jesus. All things. He was active in creation. Paul says it like this in Colossians 1. He says about Jesus, all things were created by him, and for him. So Jesus made all things, and he made all things for himself, for his glory, so people may know him. So John is making it crystal clear, as best as he knows how to us today, Jesus is God. Jesus is God. This is something we should never, ever, as Christians, get past. It is something so essential to who we are. We must know We must live our lives with the understanding that Jesus is God. That changes everything. This is not just a good man. This is not just a moral man who did good things, who helped the poor people, who healed the sick, who taught a good morality that we want our kids to have. Yes, he did those things, but it's so much more than that. He didn't just do those things for the sake of doing them. He did it because it was the essence of who God is. And what God wants us to know about himself. And Jesus is so much more than that. He's coming to show us himself. So if you are a Christian, if you're someone who claims to love God and follow Jesus, this means we need to love Jesus even more deeply than we could have ever imagined and desire to know him because he's God. So if you're not a Christian today, or you're not sure where you stand with God, know that this is what separates Christianity from every other religion in this world. Right? Muslims believe that Muhammad was a prophet and they follow what he taught, but he wasn't God. Buddhists believe that Buddha was an enlightened man who knew more knowledge than the rest of us, but he wasn't God. We, as Christians, follow Jesus, who spoke and walked and lived the very things of God. And so we worship him. We know that when he says something, it is absolutely true without a doubt. When he does something, he's modeling what God would do for us and what God would have us do. So this changes how we live. And it sets the stage for the rest of the book of John. Right? Because he's now going to talk through the rest of the book about a man and all the things he did who was God. It changes how we see things. It's not just a good story. So keep in mind that John, when he's writing this, he was probably 70 or 80 years old at the time. And he had been through so much throughout his life. Right? He had followed Jesus. He'd experienced the time when Jesus was arrested. He'd fled for his life at that point and at other times. He'd been persecuted. He'd been put in prison. He'd been exiled to an island. So don't think for a minute that John, who's writing this, didn't absolutely believe with every fiber of his being that Jesus really was God. Or he wouldn't have gone through all that. And he wouldn't have taken the time to write it down when he was 80 years old. I don't know if some of you all in this room are maybe 80 years old, and have you ever thought about writing a book when you're 80 years old? It's not typically what people think of doing in their 80s, right? But he is absolutely convinced, this is what I need to do. I need to let people know this. This Jesus that I know. So if you're going to experience life with Jesus, you have to know that he is God. But you also have to know, secondly, that he made you. That Jesus made you. So Jesus is God, as we see. And in verse 3, we see that he made everything. Everything includes you. Look at verse 3 together. All things were created through him, and apart from him, not one thing was created that has been created. So all things, including human life, Jesus was intimately involved in making. Have you ever stopped to think about that? Sometimes we think of God as just kind of a distant thought or a different distant person in our minds. Well, yeah, God made me. I believe that. But when you see God take on human form, Jesus, we have a little more clear picture of who Jesus is in our minds. Maybe we see him walking because we're humans, right? We can relate to that. Jesus made you. A God who came to us and took on our form, actually made us. And as our maker, he cares for us. Makers care for the things they make. Do we have any handy people here in the room that like to make or build things? I'm not all that handy myself. A few people are shaking their heads out there. Somebody made this, and somebody made the table out, and I'm not going to point out any names or embarrass anybody this morning. Some of you all know who that is. But we value things that we physically make, don't we? So one of the things I was able to make, even though I'm not handy, was last fall I built a fire pit in my backyard. So fire pits are kind of, you know, the end thing right now. And I have little boys, and I said, well, I need to teach them to be a man and build a fire, right? So we built this fire pit, and there was a lot of sweat equity in it, and it's not like a masterpiece. My father-in-law came over, well, why didn't you think about doing this? Or I'm like, come on now, you know. But there's a lot of sweat equity in building that. It took time and effort and energy, and it was hot. And I had my kids come and help me. And when I say help, I mean that loosely. They actually did more work that caused me more work. But they thought they were helping. And as a result, they now value that final product a lot more than they would have if they didn't help, if they just watched me do it. Like, they'll look at it and say, I helped you build that, Daddy. I helped you build it. And they take a pride or a value in that because they value what they made. My son, who likes to build Legos, he takes pride in building a Lego set. Well, Jesus is the same way. God is the same way, right? He made us. And so he highly values us above anything else in creation. We are told, as we've been looking in the past few months at Genesis and manhood and womanhood, that we are made in his image. So how much does he value us if he made us like himself? So we see the love that Jesus has for us rooted in him creating us. And so there's two realities as we think about the fact that Jesus is in the creation business, right? He creates, and he still creates. He recreates. But there's two things as we think about the fact that Jesus is a creator that come to our mind. Two truths. First is his power. To make something, you have to have a sense of power. To make all creation, to make human beings, is powerful. He can literally take nothing and make the whole world. He can take dust of the ground and form a man. He can take a rib out of a side of a man and make a woman. That's power. I can't do those things. I don't know about you all. So as much pride as I take in that fire pit, there's nothing compared to what Jesus can do, what he can make. He can do anything. And so as we are going to read through the book of John, we're going to see Jesus do some miracles. We're going to see kind of seven signs that John shows us that show Jesus' divinity. And as we think about his power in creation, we can see, well, now these miracles make sense. Because he's that powerful, he can do anything. If he made this sick person, he can surely heal him. So we see that who we are and who we and how we live should reflect the power of Jesus in our life. Because this is the God who has come to us and now says he lives in us. Do you realize you have this kind of power in your life if you are a Christian? Do you live that way? Or are you trying to find power in yourself or in someone else? Right? This is the power that God wants us to experience in our lives. We also think of, when we think of God as creator, as Jesus as creator, we think of his knowledge. If he's creator, he knows all things because he put all things here. He has intimate knowledge of who we are. He knows our deepest struggles, our deepest sorrows, our deepest experiences in this life. The things that are weighing us down right now, God knows those things. And find hope and find comfort that he has not left us to ourselves in those things. He doesn't just know about it and then leave. No, what we're going to see here in just a moment is he sends his son because of those things. Because he knows where we are. He knows the depth of our need. And he knows that what we need most is him. That we need joy, that we need peace that comes with him in our life. And know that he rules over all those things. He does. And so with this power and with this knowledge of us, why would we then not look to him? If he's that powerful, if he really does know all those things, why would we try to do it on our own? God is calling us, come to me, seek me, find me, and you will find what you need. That's what he's saying to us here. So Jesus gave us physical life as creator. He was God himself, but he wants to give us life beyond just the physical, okay? He wants to give us life just beyond our physical presence here, day in, day out. So the third thing we see here that John highlights to introduce this book, and this is called the prologue, the first 18 verses, introduction of the book. The third thing he tells us is, look, you need to know that Jesus wants to give you new life. He's given you life already. He wants to give you new life. Like I said, Jesus is in the creation business. And he wants to give new life. So his power is not just a physical power. He rules over all things. So he wants to recreate us as fallen human beings back into the image of God that he made us to be. This is who he wants us to be again. Back to the garden. Back to Adam and Eve who rebelled against him. He wants to take us back there. So we see in verse 4 a shift. Right? John writes, he's been talking about creation. Now he's going to shift it to a spiritual theme. Look at verse 4. Talking about Jesus. Life was in him, and that life was the light of men. That light shines in the darkness, yet the darkness did not overcome it. All right, so we see kind of these themes of life and light introduced here. And universally, life and light have a religious themes to them. Like all religions, if they're talking about God or their idea of God, they tend to equate that with life and light. And we know that death and darkness are kind of the opposite of that, aren't they? Darkness, death, it's kind of like an evil, there's evilness in that. A cloud, you know, you just kind of have a bad picture of death and darkness. Well, Jesus is the opposite of that. In him is life and light. So we see this picture of him coming into this struggle of darkness. And he's bringing hope. He's bringing God into those things. So John here is linking creation to salvation. Because at the beginning, we know that God created light, right? In creation. Now he's bringing light into the darkness of this world that already exists. So he's moving us from, yes, Jesus is intimately involved in creation, but he's also intimately involved in salvation to what is here and now, right now. So Jesus is essential to both. Jesus truly is meant to be the center of all we are. Our physical being, our emotional being, our spiritual being. Everything about us has to be rooted in him. This is what John is trying to get us to see. And then we see in verse 6 through 8, he turns his attention to John the Baptist. Why would he do that? It seems like why would he talk about John the Baptist when he's talking about all these great things about who Jesus is? Well, it's because throughout the Old Testament, the history of God speaking, he sent prophets to show that he was going to do something great. He's going to tell them what was going to happen to them, to let them know what he was going to do in this world. And so now he's saying, look, this is so true that I am sending a prophet, a new prophet. It's been 400 years since Israel had a prophet at this point. I'm going to send John to announce this great thing that I am doing, this life, this light that I am bringing into this dark world you find yourself in. And so John serves as proof that God is doing something great, something new, after 400 years of silence. And then we see in verses 9 through 13, God announces the great thing that he's going to do. The great thing that Jesus is coming to this world for. So first we see the need for why Jesus had to come. Look at verses 9 through 11. The true light who gives light to everyone was coming into the world. He was in the world and the world was created through him, yet, and here's a big yet, the world did not recognize him. He came to his own and his own people did not receive him. So we see the depth of the need of the world here. In the book of John, when you see the world, when you see the word world, it's not talking about like the earth as we know it, necessarily. It's talking about creation in rebellion against its creator. So keep that in mind. So when Jesus came to the world, he came to people in rebellion against him. That's what that word means. And so that we see that John is trying to show us, look, people are rebelling against God. They've turned their back on him. They didn't even recognize Jesus when he came. Very few people. Even his own people, Israel, people that God had called out for himself to reveal himself to the nations, didn't recognize the Messiah when he came. Didn't recognize God, the God that they claimed to worship when he came. Because of their rebellion. Because they were blind to the truth as the New Testament tells us. And so we see that God came to these people. There's a need here. A deep need. And this is all of us in this room. Apart from God, we are all in rebellion. We are all in darkness. We have all rebelled against our Creator. And so God tells us in Isaiah that many would see but not understand. And that's what John is getting at here. They saw Jesus, but they didn't understand who he was because they were hardened. So I want us to see, look, see yourself in this passage. Recognize that you did not recognize Jesus when you were born into this world. God had to do something in you before you could see him. But it doesn't end with that word of hopelessness, right? That's our need, but God meets that need. Look at verse 12 and 13. Jesus comes and he says, but to all who did receive him, he gave them the right to be children of God. To those who believe in his name, who are born not of blood, or of the will of the flesh, or of the will of man, but of God. They're born of God. God gives birth to them. He gives them new birth. And we're going to see this come back in John as well. We have to be born again. Right? This is what we have been waiting for. This is what the readers of John's gospel have been waiting for. They need life with God. And they know it. They've been in rebellion against him. And so this is now a way that we can become God's own children, His own family. And He brings us and calls us His own. And so John says, look, this happens. He describes it in two ways. Right? Did you catch that? He says, this life comes to you when you receive Him. When we receive somebody into our house, what do? We welcome them, don't we? We open the door and we say, come on in. Let's sit down. Let's talk. Let's have a meal together. That's what John is saying. When you receive Jesus, you say, come on in to my life. Let's commune together. Let's talk. Let's welcome. You're welcome here. So John said, you have to do that with Jesus. You have to recognize who He is as God and welcome Him into your life. Not just in your head as a fact, but into your life. And then he says, so we receive Him, but we also have to believe in His name. So we believe a lot of things, but believing in a name, he's saying not just a, I believe my name is Andy. Well, that's not what he means here. He's saying a name in this culture entails all of who a person is. It entails their character, their very being. So we have to believe in the character, the being of who Jesus is, and we have to receive Him into our lives. We have to invite Him in. We have to know Him and live with Him, is what John is saying. This is how we are born of God. This is how we live in spite of our past rebellion. And what a miracle that is, that we can actually do that. And that there's nothing that we can physically do. We just have to trust Him fully, completely with our lives. Are we living that way? If we claim to be Christians today, are we living like we trust God? Really? Have you ever trusted God in your life? Have you ever made that decision, or have you just tried to do it on your own? Do you see your need for Him? Do you see that all your ways will never get you where you want to get? Only Jesus brings life into us. So Jesus came on a rescue mission from heaven to earth. This is God coming to us to rescue us. And every one of us find ourselves in verses 10 and 11, naturally rebelling and turning away from Him. But we can be brought back to Him. He can give us the life that we long for. So think about your life today. What are some things that you've done in this past week that you know did not please God? Every one of us should be able to come up with something, okay? If you can't, you just need to be honest with yourself, okay? Every time in your life you've ever lied, every time you've ever gotten drunk or gotten high or cheated on a loved one or been lazy at work, anybody ever been lazy at work? Been selfish or prideful in any sense? All those things are verses 10 and 11. Not receiving Jesus, not worshiping Him as we should. That's verses 10 and 11. But Jesus came to forgive all those things in our life. That we may be born again and not live life forever like that. We can have a new life where we are fully in communion with God. We are no longer separated from Him. And we long for that day when one day there will be no more sin, no more of those things in our life. And God does that. He begins changing us the moment He comes into us. So we become more and more like verses 12 and 13, and less like verses 10 and 11. It doesn't happen overnight. It's a process. God does that in us as we know Him more, as we love Him more. And how do we love Him more? When we see Him for who He really is. What we see in this passage. Jesus came so you could be forgiven, so you could be restored back to God and experience the life-changing power of Him in your life. Every day. Because He values you as His special creation. So do you get a sense in this passage, as I do when I read this, of how great Jesus really is? The fact that He would make us from nothing, and that He wants to remake us in spite of all we've done to walk away from Him. That's how much Jesus loves us. Live in that love today. Let it change the way you think. Let it change the way you feel. Let it change the way you interact with other people. Like, we don't have to live in darkness anymore. We can live in the light of His love. So I want us to grasp the vision of the greatness of our God. And know that our lives are worth giving it all to Him, to this Jesus. That defined the life of this author, right? He gave it all for this Jesus that he knew personally. And this is what he wants for us to experience. And to know that when we believe and we live like this, it is completely worth it. It's worth so much more than anything else this world has to offer. Let me challenge you today. Live with this conviction of this great God in your life. Let's pray together. God, we thank you for this great truth that you have shown us in your word this morning of who Jesus really is. And the fact that you would love us so much, that you would come down from heaven, the God who made us, the God who created us, who knows us deeply and intimately and personally, the God who has power over all things, that you would come to us so that we may be born of you, that we may be recreated into who you meant us to be from the beginning, in spite of all we've done to avoid that. God, I pray that each one of us here in this room would live with you as the center of our lives, that you would bring life and light to us in the darkness that we are facing right now in this world, the darkness that we are facing in our personal lives, whatever that may be today. We all have different struggles. We all have different things that are causing fear and shame and guilt and worry in our lives. Yet you bring a light to all those things. You show us what we really need and the hope that we have in Christ. May we experience that in a new way today. Some of us, may we experience it for the first time today. Lord, help us to encounter you. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So maybe this morning you've